So I'd like to introduce our first speaker. It's Stefan McLaughlin, and Steph and I have a bit of a history through BFN. We did a project together with Hollow Water First Nation. Some of you folks will remember Gary Raven. Gary had done a three-year pilot study with staff on behalf of the Boreal Forest Network called the Soaring Eagle Project. And that project combined Western science with traditional knowledge. And so they learned how to go out and get scientific samples. And they also got their trapper's licenses and did other traditional activities. So this is kind of a specialty of Stefan's. And now he's been involved with the communities that are downstream from the Athabasca Delta, one of them being ACFN, which is the community that Neil Young just recently did the tour in support of. We know who Neil is. Steph is with the Conservation Lab at the University of Manitoba, and I'd like to welcome him, please.
So, hard act to follow and an even harder one to proceed, but I guess you could call me the stuffy professor, and it's kind of funny. I was putting together my presentation today, and whenever I'm anxious, I go check out ratemyprofessor.com and see if my rating has changed at all, and it's still 2.3 out of 5, and so my name's misspelled, and I'm mistakenly located in the Faculty of Science, but after the show, if you want to kind of increase my rating, that'd be great. The other part, too, is my dad still teaches. He's 76 years old, and his rating is 4.6, so it's twice as high as mine. Okay, enough about me. I want to spend the next 25 minutes talking about this work that we've been doing in collaboration with the Mikisew Cree and the Athabasca Chippewan First Nation in northern Alberta. Michael Tice, who's up in the front here, put together a lot of the video clips that you're going to see. What's important about this work is that right from the get-go, right from the beginning, it was shaped and directed by those two First Nations. And they actually called me and asked me to write some funding proposals to fund some work that they wanted to do. Some other important things is that it's holistic in approach, and so it covers off the environment and wildlife and human health. And it's also what we call a three-track in approach. So it incorporates Western science, which is my base, but also it's grounded in and given meaning by the traditional knowledge that these people bring to the table. So, I think most of you know exactly where Fort Chippewyan is and where the tar sands are. But it's this community in this delta, the Peace Athabasca Delta, located 200 miles downstream from the tar sands. Originally, I've been told that I should focus by the leadership on the tar sands and look at those implications, the environmental and health implications. But talking to the elders that act as an advisory group to our project, they told me that I shouldn't start there and that it should be much more holistic in approach and incorporate all the other stressors. So it's a complex and far-reaching project. When you spend time in town and talk to people, you find out very, very quickly that the context that they work with is the past and time immemorial and the fact that things used to be a lot better than they are today. If your eyes are better than mine, you can read that, but what's important is that whenever people talk about the past, it's in positive, affirming terms when their traditions and their livelihoods were in place. You've seen this map, you won't be able to see much, sorry, but to the left in northern BC, you'll see the W.A.C. Bennett Dam, which was constructed in the mid-1960s and which began this changing that took place to the landscape. Here you see it. You see the impoundment reservoir on your right-hand side, I guess, and you see what's left of the Peace River on the left, and so it's had a dramatic impact on the flow of that river. for those of you who are on top of these issues, you'll know that they're planning another large dam that they're calling Site C, which is further going to impact the flow of the Peace River. And of course, we have the tar sands themselves, all the operations that use an incredible amount of water. And so together, those stressors on the Athabasca River flowing northward and the Peace flowing northeast has had a tremendous impact on the what's referred to as the Peace-Athabasca Delta, this really wonderfully diverse and kind of expansive landscape. And what you'll see then is on the photo to the right is a lot of these small inland lakes are drying up. And so here we have Archie Antoine, and he's telling us that lake, which no longer exists and which is being replaced by bulrushes and willows, used to kind of be about four feet tall. Here's the first of the video clips that we're going to play.
Hey, how are you doing? I'll show you. You'll be like proper someday. You'll listen to me, you know? Real good one. The rats, you know right away, as soon as they come up, you know, if you don't close the push up right, they just come up their nose, you go right back. Pretty smart boy.
The reason why we're out here is we're doing a muskrat survey, which consists of two First Nations group and a Métis, local Métis group and Parks Canada. In the 60s and 70s, they used to go around and do muskrat surveys. Hey, tar sand, we're rich, yep. Oil. But if we have rats, we could be rich too. But yep. I guess long ago, when you were trapping here in this area, there was a lot of rats, yes? Back it up 30 years?
Yeah. Well, it would be about 3-4 feet of water, maybe about 500.
Really?
Rat houses. Push-ups and all, you know.
Yeah.
Mud.
No water there.
Look
no.
Right up, boy.
That little young muskrat, when he's born, he has to jump in that water and live in that water. And that's why I think we lost our muskrat habitat.
Nyan nom tahtum no no tosum the nom stigaski it pamwa pahtaho. Magiguinan tong gotas namista. Uksumane gutahata. Yim kustagi gotas kogmane gutahata.
From the abundance of muskrats we used to have here to absolutely zero, that hurts.
That's our problem. We need water for to have muskrat. And we need good water, not polluted water. Like we're having today on the Athabasca River.
And so what you've heard then is that not only are the impacts substantial on the water quantity, the hydrology of the area, they have tremendous implications for the wildlife species. And so muskrat we focused on because it's what we call a cultural keystone species. It's absolutely crucial to those communities in terms of economic value and cultural value, and as we'll find out, as a source of food. So obviously, in addition to the impacts and implications for water quantity, kind of the oil sands or the tar sands are obviously kind of tied to a lot of environmental contaminants. Here's a picture of one of the main ones, methylmercury, that we tested for. But also we tested for others, cadmium and arsenic and another chemical called selenium, all associated with industry. One of the challenges when you do this kind of collaborative research is how to communicate scientific data in a kind of a meaningful, respectful manner with people who don't have a scientific background. And these are the kinds of kind of default approaches that result. Our approach was to take something that's called consumption limits. So what we did is we tested a whole variety of different kinds of wildlife, including muskrat, And we tested the muscle as well as the kidneys and the livers. And not only did we come up with those data, but we translated them into how much it was safe for people to eat, given the kind of toxin that we were testing for and the concentration in that particular organ of the wildlife. What's important to see here is there's lots of red and lots of orange, and those are red flags and orange flags, so indicating that caution or kind of extreme care should be taken when you eat those tissues. And so it's this is a bad situation, obviously, because what we'll show in a few secs is that that people still eat a tremendous amount of these traditional foods that have been contaminated by upstream industry. This is an example of whitefish being smoked, which is still eaten by many in the area. And again, sorry, I'll read part of this, but basically, if you can read it, it's someone saying that they still eat a tremendous amount of traditional foods, and this woman who was participating in our research was doing so while her family members were out in the land consuming food. I'm not going to bore you with the details of this, but this is what we went out and we surveyed what people ate in the community, and then ranked them in order of decreasing frequency from the most frequently eaten species to the least frequently eaten. And what's highlighted there is that moose is most frequently eaten. This was over a two-month period, followed by rat root or wike, which many of you will know is a medicine, and then duck, and then wild mint, and then spruce gum, and then pickerel. And so what's interesting there is you have a whole mix of plants and wildlife being eaten. Some are medicines and some for sustenance. What's also important to note is that muskrat, which would have been an absolutely key species in the diets of both these First Nations just 50 years ago, has effectively been eliminated from the diet, because it's been extirpated or eliminated from the landscape by industry, as that previous video showed. So that's one kind of impact. There's also the impact that comes from people being frightened by scientists like me going up and telling them that there are all these contaminants in their food. And so here what we see is someone in a focus group saying, oh, definitely, I am the same way. I've quit eating fish. I will not eat fish from Lake Athabasca. And actually, that's not so much because they're kind of these concerns are real, because in fact that the traditional foods are generally still pretty safe, but because people are worried and scared about all the toxins that they're being told are in the food. When you're in Fort Chip and you walk around, you see a lot of these boats. And these are kind of fishing boats that are rotting onshore, because along with those fears, you've seen the collapse of the commercial fisheries that used to play such a dominant role in the region on Lake Athabasca. Another thing that we did, and sorry, it's hard to see this, but this is actually a wall documenting the people who have passed from the community. And so this that I'll be reporting in a very parenthetical kind of way is the first kind of collaborative health study that's being done. And this is a community that's been calling for such a study now for many decades. And some of you have heard of John O'Connor and some of the kind of trouble that he got into, making the rest of us aware of the challenges that confront these communities. And since then, they've really been pushing for a baseline study. This is a body mapping exercise that kind of we and the participants kind of undertook, where basically 100 people documented the illnesses that they'd suffered from. And what you can see here is that there are a tremendous number of illnesses. I won't go in detail here because we won't release these data for another month. But some of these are characteristic of many northern indigenous communities, and a lot, I would argue, especially the cancers, are unique to Fort Chipewyan. Diabetes was kind of high, as with many communities. And so here you have a quote saying it's because they can't access the traditional foods anymore because of the declines in water level. And so people are stuck buying processed foods, the only foods that they can are normally available at the local store. Asthma here was also common, and so many people talked about problems in breathing, and as it's reflected here, where someone can't even walk up the stairs because of the tremendous asthma that she experiences. Stress is another one. And so this guy says, that's one thing I noticed, that I have a lot of stress. I'm stressed out steady. My kids stress me out. My woman stresses me out. Then he laughs. And my dad, he never ever worried about nothing. He was a happy-go-lucky guy. Like I said, I'm always stressed out. And these were things that people reported to us that they were experiencing. Substance abuse is prevalent, like a lot of northern communities. And here we have someone saying, the biggest change that I see in Fort Chip is I see the drugs and alcohol in our community has damaged so many of our young people, body, mind, and soul. But of course, the thing that was most prevalent and what people talked about the most during these research that was the cancer rates. And so here we have someone saying, I came with something on my mind, came to the research group meeting, that has been bothering me about the health of the community. Some things, like I've been seeing, that I wanted to discuss, like the rate of increase of cancer. It's getting to younger and younger ages and more people. And so now here we have, again, another clip talking about the cancer issue.
It only takes the minutest trace of some chemical to really do a lot of damage to a community the size.
You know, even in Fort Chip now, we got our main intake for our drinking supply. It comes out of Lake Athabasca. And after all these years of drinking that water out of that Lake Athabasca, I'm not a bit surprised at how people are sick.
I have so many friends of mine that been gone now, like for cancer. Like a lot of them blame it because of the pollution and all that.
I lost three grandmothers, one grandfather, all the cancer, about 8 months. Me and my girlfriend, in 2006, we lost a baby, a stillbirth. A baby, a growth on his liver. That happened like two women in town, like 2 years.
I don't let my children live in Fort Chip. They can come home to visit, and they can come home if they're having a hard time. They can gather their wits or whatever. I just don't want them to have to come here, live in Fort Chip, and get cancers and have to drink this polluted water and sometimes breathe this polluted air.
There was an elder that lived off the Athabasca, and John Weeks was his name. He said he quit drinking that water, it was too polluted, and that was 25 years ago or maybe longer. The Aboriginal people along the river, they were dying from different causes, so nose cancer, everything, right? And they were drinking water right off, right in the river. He dug a well through the sand in well water. And he was the last guy still alive along the Athabasca River. It's amazing how, because he drank a different water, who knows?
You talk to some scientists, they say, look, no. It's a bit someone was there before your time, and, you know.
What does it smell like?
Kind of tar-like.
What do you believe, you know?
There's a lot of distrust in the community right now towards the government since the cancer scare. We had a big cancer scare. Well, the government has done nothing since then.
It suggests they don't care what Dr. John O'Connor is saying. They don't care what claims are coming out of Fort Chippewa. They don't care that potentially there are people dying with rare and aggressive cancers in Fort Chip. They don't care.
The Alberta Health tried to slow down this whole process. Get to the bottom of what's causing the rarest cancers. It's very frustrating to, you know, get this far and absolutely nothing's being done. Totally nothing at all.
All I just wanted to quickly go through and talk about some of the causes, which you've already heard some of the local leadership and community members talking about there. Obviously, the oil sands were identified as being a primary cause in the changes in health that the community is experiencing, something perhaps that we would expect because it's growing in terms of impact and presence on the region. Another one that surprised us a little bit was upstream agriculture. And so again, speaking to the holistic nature of these stressors and the fact that it's not just the oil sands or it's not just the kind of the hydro dams, but it's a number of other industries that are in play, especially now that they're subject to these flow changes. Country foods, and so we talked a little bit about that and some of the changes in consumption that are taking place as people recognize that many of these foods are contaminated by upstream industry. And also processed foods. And so along with the shift in nutrient transition, as some scientists talk about, as people eat less and less country food and more store-bought processed foods, people recognize that this has health implications. And as this participant talks about, that it's especially prevalent in the younger generation, in this case, their granddaughter. This in turn has implications for food security because so many of these foods are so expensive. So someone here talks about a small turkey costing $92. And so typically kind of foods are 3 to 5 times as expensive up there as they are down here. Some of the indirect causes that people talked about, again, residential schools that we can never forget about. And so here, talking about the implications for alcoholism, suicides, people going to jail, kind of tying that directly to the physical and the sexual, the emotional abuse that so many school children experienced at that time. Another indirect cause is poor communication. And so in this case, most scientists and most government researchers do very, very little to communicate the outcomes of their research to community members. And this is among the most studied communities in the world, I would say, and yet they're in a black box of communication. Something else people talked about was inadequate healthcare. And so in this case, you have a situation that people are getting sicker, and yet the healthcare that they can access within Fort Chipewyan is completely inadequate. And yet, on the other hand, even though they're flown down to Fort McMurray and to Edmonton routinely to access those professional, those medical professionals, they too are incapable, in many cases, of addressing these health issues. And what happens is the inevitable delays just creates even a worse situation. People talked about the future and the fact that it's just going to continue growing, the industry, the upstream industry, especially in terms of the tar sands, and that the situation is just going to get worse and worse unless something is done. And so in this case, kind of tying it directly, so within 20 years, people anticipate they'll look across the lake and they'll see industry there. A bleak situation, and one that people within and outside the community have cause to be angry about. At the same time, we can't characterize these communities as vulnerable or at risk. They're resilient and they're strong, and they're always finding ways of adapting to these stressors. One of the things that people talked about as that positive context was the need to focus on the traditions and to have the traditions inform their responses and, in a sense, to nurture that relationship between the elders and the children to find ways of creating opportunities for people to go on the land. Here, I'll just play. I'll do this. So the oil sands was interestingly, something that was identified, obviously both as a stressor and a cause of concern, but also an opportunity. And in this sense, it departs from the usual discourse that we have down here, where we assume that people just want to shut down the tar sands. And you'll hear some of that discourse as this video clip plays.
Umone yuinu wago kamsana chista toski atuski un skriptama matga atuski un ocha wiji wa aisino atte aisino atuski un miwitama matga mananto tihtama atte sagob maji un kapmet saho moyeksi tihtama.
I drive 797s, which is what the biggest truck in the world, but it's easy. It's like driving a car. The first day I went out, it was like a whole different world. I mean, things are huge up there, like, and it's fast going, and it scared me. I didn't think I was going to be able to do it. I thought I was going to quit like within the first week. But I mean, I had good trainers and I had good people out there that helped me get comfortable in it. And within a month, like, I was driving on my own.
You want to find meaningful employment and training for our people, and that is one area that offers us that opportunity.
Fort Chipewyan has really high unemployment. They get to have employment, and also they get to stay with their families, come back to their families in the community. Also, they're able to practice their lifestyles. That's one of the positives that industry has done for the community.
You know which people work for industry, because you see the nice boats and the nice skidoos and the nice quads outside their homes, and it's good for them. I'm happy for them. People have to put foods on their table. They have to show their kids some responsibility. They have to show their kids that, you know, they have to work. You know, you should be proud, a proud person that you can go to work and support yourself.
The other day, some guy told me I helped them destroy our land. I wasn't too happy to hear that, but I have a different point of view of looking at it. I'm looking after my family, they're my responsibility, so.
I got no argument with the industry. That's why I'm still out there. We gotta move on. You know, make a better life for yourself and for your family.
It just breaks my heart when somebody finishes grade 12 and says, well, I guess I'm gonna go to work for industry. Or else, hey, I just want to go to Northern, work in Northern.
They come for career job fairs and stuff like that at the school, like open house stuff. They'll go to the school and, oh yeah, you could be driving this big heavy hauler. And first you're 8, 9 years old, you see a big tractor, you want to jump in there and drive it, right? Why should I be struggling in the land, hunting for food, and all that when I could be driving a truck, having all the toys you want and stuff like that? They get them when they're young, so they don't like, you shouldn't even be allowed to come around bug kids in the school.
I work at the school and I tell the kids, you know, there's no reason why you have to go work at Syncrude or Suncor or any of those. Why can't you become a doctor? Why can't you become a teacher? There's more to life than industry.
There's an increasing emphasis placed on appropriate, culturally appropriate and place appropriate healthcare. So healthcare that's available within the community, like the new elder home that they're in the process of building. Something else that came up was self-care and the importance of taking responsibility. And so reversing decades of dependence on a federal and a provincial government that is unwilling to provide that support and to take agency over that. Another important aspect was this community-based monitoring as another kind of response to, and a positive and affirming response to kind of some of the shortcomings and monitoring in the region around the tar sands. Here, let me see.
Where is the law that says you must preserve caribou habitat and even the bison that we have inside of Alberta? There's no protection for those things. Rather, they fight and say, well, okay, we'll take this land out for next 40 years, mine it all out, kill off all the buffalo, reclaim, then restock, you know. That's their answer.
Industry comes in with the promise that we're going to put everything back the way it was. Well, that's bullshit. And you can paint it any color you want. Bottom line is, it's bullshit. They'll never do it.
Government certainly isn't looking out for our best interests, so it's time that we look out for our own best interests, and we're going to find out what's going on, and we're going to talk to our elders, and we're going to actually listen to what they're saying, and we're going to design a monitoring program around that.
DOM jail is 7.90.
So there's all these really subtle things that the elders are noticing that we're trying to track and follow, and then bring in the science to partially help explain in a fuller picture of what's going on.
I know a lot of people are concerned about, like, you know, the tar sands and them sending down all the junk and pollution. And nobody really can put their finger on as to why people are getting sick and why the fish and the animals are sick, you know. Doing some of this work sort of helps us get sent in the right direction.
Community-based monitoring program is ihati. Mayogi ways bega o dayabaska. Sima tatuskatama.
One dead bird. Looks like there's over 100 dead seagulls scattered. Some are fresh, some are decomposed, about a week or two old. Since the program started, we found that the water quality and quantity are both declining rapidly. For instance, last year there was a time period of about 3 weeks where there was dead fish everywhere along the Athabasca and the Amara. There was reports coming in like crazy. And
so you think any noticeable signs of oil or anything on those birds?
No. And the funny thing is they're all pretty young. Like, they just started to fly, you know?
We're not here to shut down the oil sands. We don't want to shut it down. If we shut it down, people will be out of jobs and they'll have no income for their families. We want to work with industry and government. Without the CBM program, we won't be finding all this. And like, involve us more, use us in all their monitoring, and we could effectively manage the environment together.
And so finally, resistance. And so these are strong communities. They don't want to shut down. As you just heard Jonathan say, they don't want to shut down industry, but they want to hold it accountable and they want to be meaningfully involved. And not just for their own communities and for their own families, but in fact, using those treaty-defined rights for the rest of Canadians as well. And I think that's important to reflect on. And so here we have Mike Mercury from ACFN talking about, we're adaptive though, we are resilient. They, i.e. we, have tried to exterminate us in so many ways, you know. We are here now. It's another fight now, another roar. Right now, we are in the front line speaking this and getting the word out. And so I think this is a good way to end because it talks about the strength and the resilience in these communities. Just kind of a few highlights. We're anticipating on the left-hand side here, you'll see the cover page of the report that right now is being held up by government, going through and giving us feedback, and it's taking longer than we had hoped for. But we think it's an important credibility check that they get involved in the process. And so we anticipate it'll be out in May. On the right-hand side, I don't know if you can see, but it says OneRiverTheFilm.ca. So in the fall, we're going to release this film documentary that we produced in collaboration with the two First Nations, and it'll be kind of a worldwide in terms of its distribution. And finally, on the bottom, we have OneRiverNews.ca, which we're using as a portal, in a sense, to make a lot of this information available to other stakeholders. But especially community members, and to make that community voice accessible to people who live outside the region. And so that's it for me. Thank you. You can't possibly read all the people that have been involved in this project, but it just speaks to the nature of how community-based and collaborative it has been in approach. Thank you.